and welcome to the Nuit report for the week of October 9th. I'm April Shaley of aprilsastrology.com, and welcome to this weekend where we have, which is followed by, I was going to say the new moon is happening this weekend. It's happening on Monday the 12th, and it's going to be a really good opportunity to sort of get some new energies flowing, because we've been dealing with Mercury retrograde. Luckily today's the 9th that I'm making this recording, Mercury goes direct. I'll tell you exactly when it happened. It happened at 10:58 a.m. Oh, it's about 6 minutes from now, Eastern time. So as I'm making this video, Mercury is going direct. Are you pleased with that news? Because I am. But Mercury retrogrades are, of course, a great opportunity to go inside, to revision, reevaluate, remember, anything with the prefix re. It's a good time. Respect, to look again, renew, right? So another nice feature is that Venus is coming out of her shadow stage. So remember, she was retrograde for a while there. It takes a while, you know, she goes direct, but takes a while for her to come out of this shadow stage that she's in, until she reaches a point, once she goes direct again, she has to keep going forward until she reaches a point where she's gone beyond the point of the zodiac where she went backwards. You follow? So she was going, before the retrograde, she was going forward, she hit a certain point in the zodiac, started going backwards, then went over it again, going direct, and then now has moved into new territory in Virgo. So she had gone retrograde at the beginning of Virgo. So now she's at 3 degrees Virgo for this new moon. She will be getting close to conjuncting Mars, and she will be getting closer to Jupiter. She's not quite there yet, but she'll be opposing Neptune. So this can murky up the waters in relationships and make us sort of get, you know, people that we're interested in, if it's a new attraction, we might get like a rosy glow over, you know, you see them in a certain light, a soft focus sort of light. And we need to perhaps careful about that. Just let time tell you a little bit more about what this is going to become before you jump, you go over to Vegas to get married. And so Mercury's gone direct, Venus has gone out of her shadow period. This is a good indication that we're ready for some forward motion, you know. Perhaps we've been in the planning stages of some event or some sort of creative project, and now is the time that those things start to get rolling and we can see some really good forward motion in those kinds of things. Business plans, any sort of communication that we might be waiting for may start, those kinds of messages may start coming in now where they've been sort of wonky. I know, like, we're planning an event and we were, you know, my partner for this event and myself that are working on this, we're planning this event, and we actually, an email just disappeared that we were both sent. Neither of us could find it in our inbox during this Mercury retrograde period. So lots of stuff like that. And so that wonky, you know, that's going to start smoothing out. But Mercury also has a shadow period, you guys. So it does take a while for things to really, you know, smooth out. It doesn't just happen instantly. But you'll see over the weekend things start to, you know, get straightened out a little bit better. Okay? And then the new moon is a I keep shaking this camera. The new moon is sort of a reactivation point, which is, I think, we could really use at this point. So for the new moon, you'll see me glancing this way. I'm looking at the chart in front of me so I can sort of tell, look at the astrologies, look at the pie with all the symbols on it, and then I tell you guys like what that means, according to me. All right, so we've got, this new moon will be exactly opposite Uranus. And it'll be in a square aspect or tension aspect. Oppositions are tension also with Pluto. So, and the moon is in Libra at this point. It's going to be at, this new moon's going to be at 19 degrees Libra at 8:06, I think. Let me just double check that. 8:06 p.m. Eastern time. Hi, sweet boy. How you doing? So, this new moon will be very, yeah. So remember, like in many Nuit reports past, for those of you who've been watching for a while, for those of you who are new, I'll do a little bit of review. Since like 2011, I would say even earlier than that, we've had an ongoing, or we had an ongoing, I'd say we still have an ongoing Uranus-Pluto square. These are like the two big mahafs in the planets, you know. Pluto is the chthonic one, you know, Lord Hades, god of the underworld, the dark goddess herself, we could even say, all that is below and is unconscious and is beneath the surface. And Uranus is that which is above, the sky god. This is the vision and the world of ideas, the airy realms, electricity, newness, that kind of sudden release of energy is also what Uranus is about. Uranus also rules inventions and things being a new, when Uranus makes major configurations, we get a sudden shift in the zeitgeist. And so with Pluto and Uranus making this square, which has happened for several years now, a lot has changed. I mean, think about, particularly since 2012, for most people, a lot of life circumstances have really shifted for most of us, I think. And so that was a collective kind of awakening. Now, one of my favorite astrologers, the venerable and very important astrologer, Rick Levine, talks about the lag of seasons, and that it takes some time for, when something's that big, that huge of a shift, it takes time for the shift to really manifest. So the last time Uranus and Pluto were in relationship to one another was the 1960s. And then, so that happened earlier in the 1960s. Those of you who were born in the 60s will have that Pluto-Uranus conjunction in your birth chart. And then as the 60s went on, that's when the early 60s were really huge change, times of change as well. But it continued on through the late 60s and into the early 70s. It's the same with this one. So the big changes, you know, that you'll see if you follow what's going on the world stage, you know, and you'll see that these things are still continuing to unfold, right? And in our own personal lives as well. Those of us who are very sensitive and very sort of tuned in probably had a lot of these changes already and now are starting to even out. But people who are a little bit denser, sorry to be a jerk, but some people, man, you guys, some of you don't like to change. You're gonna hold on. You're gonna hold on, you know? And I'm sorry for you guys, because now is the time where it's like forced, you know? And some people, you know, I don't want to predict awful things happening to anybody because we don't want to hold that thought form, but, you know, it's the kind of thing where you want to go with it. You really want to go with it as much as you can. You want to step into change, you know, and not resist it, because that's what life is all about. It's part of what it's all about, is constant motion. To stop moving is to stop living. Life is motion, right? So this new moon, getting back to what I was originally starting this discussion about, is this new moon. And it's going to renew itself. Luna, the divine feminine, the great mother, renews herself at the new moon. She makes a conjunction or fuses together with the divine masculine, the sun. And they rebirth the cycle and until the full, where it culminates, and then it sort of winds down until the next new moon. So this weekend we're in the dark moon, by the way. So this is a great time for divination. This is a great time for introspection, and especially as the season is descending here in the northern hemisphere. For those of you in the south, it's a great time to vision what you're going to do with your summer ahead. But so with the new moon, within this, touching on this square, we might get, the moon is about the past. So we might get a, little bit of a review of these last couple years and the decisions that we've made, and make some, fine-tune some adjustments, fine-tune things and adjust them so that they're more relevant to where we currently are. And it might be a nice time to reflect on that this weekend, like, wow, how has my life changed? And what kinds of changes did I resist, perhaps, and what might I do about that now? And, give yourself a little pat on the back for the ways that you have gone with the flow. You, as these next years unfold, if you did allow for that change to occur, if you did step into that new phase of life, you're going to find, I think, that it's going to bear fruit over these next few years. And those of you who didn't, no time like the present. I mean, you can always start following your bliss now. And that's how you know when you're in alignment, is when you are in your bliss. I've been seeing these quotes going around on Facebook. I just have to say something about this because I think it's not that smart. And, I don't want to put myself in resistance to this because, there's a lot that I don't know about the world, certainly. But this is something I wanted to say, is that I'm seeing a lot of these things about enlightenment, and that enlightenment is tough, hard work, and that you suffer when you've become enlightened, or when you start to move toward enlightenment, you can expect to suffer. And it seems to be put out by people who feel like they've got some street cred for having suffered like this, and they've gone through whatever they've gone through that they thought was going to bring them closer to enlightenment. And now they're telling us how hard that is, and they're part of this exclusive club, maybe, where they're enlightened because they've gone to whatever country they've gone to learn whatever they've learned and meditate however long they're going to meditate, and, gone through the rituals or whatever it's going to be. And I'm not dismissing any of that necessarily as invalid. It's, of course, wonderful to have these opportunities and to do these things. My point is that when you've got somebody telling you how difficult it is to become enlightened and how you can expect pain and suffering, my question for you, dear listener, is how does that feel? What's the feeling tone of that? Does that feel light to you? Does that feel buoyant? Does that feel in alignment with the Godhead? Or does it feel like a human being with a big fat ego? That's kind of what I'm thinking. That sounds to me like bragging. And it sounds to me like someone telling me how hard it is to transcend your ego and then feeding their ego by telling me that. Like, what are you talking about? So why I'm bringing this up is not to put anybody down, but to say, hey, I don't know about that one. How about this? How about we kind of know when we're aligned because it feels good? When you're thinking of somebody who's really like got their shit together spiritually and you're around that person, do you feel like you're pushing a boulder up a hill when you're around them? Or do you feel like they're difficult or they're going to challenge? Like, people that I'm aware of that I've come across, or that I've, been exposed to even via YouTube, have a ease about them and are often smiling and laughing, or they are generous and they're not spending any time almost at all putting anyone else down or trying to set up obstacles to anybody else. They're actually trying to draw people in and extend a hand and say, hey, this is how I did it, and I'd like to share that with you. Not saying I'm part of this elite group and good luck, you know, for you, and these are the obstacles in your way, and I hope you suffer like I had to. that's not the show. So, anyway, this is what, so this new moon can show us a little bit more. If we want to tune in, can give us a little bit more information, if we're listening, to what it is that that our bliss is, and what's exciting for us, and where, what direction we can move into. So our guardian angel, or our higher self, if you will, our connection to the divine, whatever you want to call this, I don't really care. But that guiding intelligence that actually resides within, pretty much right here, we are spoken to, we speak with that intelligence via how we feel and where we yearn toward and what makes the hours pass by and what we find beautiful and what makes us feel lighter and freer and more generous and more grounded and aligned and beautiful and excited about the world, you know, forcing ourselves into practices that, like, you know, are like self-flagellation and then telling everybody we're getting enlightened like that. You know what I find? This is just one more thing I want to share with you. This is not even on topic for astrology, but hey, Mercury's going direct today and I'm chatty. So I find that the way most people experience what they call God or divinity, or the way that they see that they need to move toward enlightenment, is how they experience their parents. So, because parents, especially, you know, are God to us when we're infants, right? They're omnipotent. They have all the power, and they're the source of love and all the things that we sort of see as that. And I find that most people feel that the way that they can get they can attain that union, the path that they tend to set up for themselves tends to be, have the same feeling tone as the way that they experienced their parents growing up. So oftentimes people who experience their parents as very punitive and judgmental will seek God that way. And people who experience their parents as inclusive and loving will feel in union with God that way. And I keep putting God in quotes. That's sort of the way I don't offend you if you don't call the, you know, God. But, you know, am I trying to be a wise guy? Not right this second. So, anyway, new moon, getting us more aligned up. And it's, again, it's going to trigger that square. So we get a little review, you know, as Mercury continues to move out of the shadow period here. And then we've got Mars involved with Neptune getting up to Jupiter. Mars is kind of getting pumped up, so, you know, there's definitely some fuck or fight energies going on right now. Venus is coming into play. This can be actually really exciting times for relationships, for sex, for anything where we're like a creative powers, you know, if you're an artist or you're, you know, that art energy comes out of sexual energy, even if it doesn't seem like it's really connected or it's more sublimated or covert, it still comes out of that same energy. It still comes out of that merging of inspiration and embodiment and, you know, that mediumship that is the feminine. And that, you know, mastered focus and intention and, you know, mastered ability to use the world and direct energy, which is the masculine, that's kind of what creates art, right? So so that is where anything creative that comes from the union of the masculine and the feminine that way. Sexuality, same thing. So this is an exciting period for that kind of stuff. You know, Venus is going to come into that opposition with Neptune that I mentioned at the beginning of this report. So again, you want to be careful about, you know, who you think is super. I'm not saying you should, you know, it can be really heart-opening energy too, and I'm not really in the business of telling people to, like, heart guard a lot, because that's, I think it can be really counterproductive, because then you shut down your, like, central intelligence system. you know, the junction between the mind and the gut and the lower, you know, this is sort of where it all, this is like the control board, and we get the messages through our emotional bodies. That's our navigational system, and the center of that is the heart, of course. But, you know, take care of yourself. Pay attention to what your heart is actually saying, not just what you want it sort of to be saying about someone. So that would be the only thing I would really say about that. And then, you know, Mars and Venus in opposition, they're sort of on each side of the degree, you know, orb of degrees to making that opposition. That's really great creative energy. So this is a great time if you're a painter to paint, if you're a sculptor to sculpt, make films, you know, write poems, dance, you know, do that kind of stuff and have a really good time with it. Even if you think you're not good at it, why not try? All right, so let's, I want to mention before I do our cards, I want to mention that I have a class that I'm offering, a webinar. A lot of you had responded to my question if you'd like to have a webinar on Saturn, because we're talking about it so much in one of the reports, and I got a lot of feedback from you that you would like that. So here's your opportunity to sign up for that and take the class. So it's in three parts. It's a webinar. You can get on live on the webinar if you wish, or you can just partake in the recordings, and I send all the handouts and all that kind of stuff after the class to everybody, and the recording Earl. So if you can't make the class, that's, I think I have it scheduled for 7 o'clock. First class is November 4th, and they're happening, there's three of them. So the part, you know, you can look at the link, but we're going to go over Saturn as an archetype. We're going to go over Saturn in the birth chart, and then we're going to go over moving transits from Saturn. Like, what's a Saturn transit, and why does everybody sound so, like, unhappy about them? Like, how can I make them good for me? Because you really can. You totally can. But we get into the mythology of Saturn is, like, amazingly, like, there's so much to it, and I'm so excited to do this webinar. It's really fun, I think. And I think it could give us all, you know, even I'm even learning new things as I'm getting prepared for it. I'm like, wow, right, there's that connection with Saturn and this archetype and that. So I think we're going to have a really good time. So sign up for that if you will. And don't wait until the end. The more people I know that are coming, the happier I am. I can look forward to seeing you. Okay, so let's shuffle the cards. I've already made this long. You know, I always think I'm just going to have a couple things to say, and then, you know, there's not really much to talk about today. I don't even know what I'm going to say. And then I get to here with you guys, and I just have lots to say every time. All right. Okay. Here's our card for the week. Ready? Let's pick it. All right. Oh, very nice card. Put this down. It's gonna shake. Boom. Okay, ready? Strength. That's a good one. I mean, they're all good ones, but this is nice. This is 8, which is actually the number of Saturn, even though Saturn's not really associated with this card. Strength. And, you know, we're not really in Leo season right now. We went through a lot of these Leo energies before. But strength is, I see this card a lot, you know, in terms of the power of the feminine. And the working with our animal nature. And of course, you know, earlier in the report I was talking about the heart is a navigational system. And the lion, you know, Leo rules the heart. And when we're in alignment with our hearts and our hearts are open, that is actually more of a source of courage that helps us align with our courage a lot more than shutting the heart center down does. When we shut the heart center down, we get really brittle. And it's really tempting to do that because short-sightedly, we humans think we're protecting by doing that. You know, you see people who sort of hang out like this all the time. that's like protecting that area in the solar plexus, you know, but opening up the heart is really crucial if you want to be aligned and you want to be enlightened. I mean, you can't get around that. People try to get around that, especially in the world of magic, you know, people try to intellectualize their way through it and you kind of can't. You just can't do that. You got to pass through. So this is that wisdom of the feminine that, you know, she's robed, she's got the sign of infinity over her head, so that this is divinity and this is infinite possibility. And she's working, you know, she's not harming this lion in any way, you know? I mean, I don't know what the lion was doing earlier. If she's shutting the lion's mouth or if she's opening the mouth, we don't know. The lion is color of fire. So this is, you know, this is the divine feminine within us, the, working with our passions and instead of trying to subdue them, you know? Gosh, I think of the whole Cecil the Lion thing. And of course, there was a lot of controversy around that with, you know, all sorts of viewpoints, and you know, some people over sentimentalize some things about that incident, but I think it affected people so much because it was the slaughter of the symbol of the lion, the heart itself, like the collective heart and courage and the strength of nature, and that it's just the sovereignty, the archetype. I'm like feeling around for what I mean about that. But that regal sovereign beauty that and so that somebody would want to shoot that for something cute, you know, to feel like a big shot. Basically, the ego, you know, incarnated in this jackass dentist dude, you know, who thought he was a big shot, probably doesn't now, but anyway, that's that kind of conflict. So this is a way that we're shown in this card of how to relate to that energy in a way that's harmonious and cooperative and gentle, that energy within us. So with that, this report is complete. Have a wonderful week. And until next time, take care.